Freestyle. الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We're gonna be taking تفسير سورة الفاتحة. And if you don't have a pen and paper, I would encourage you to try to get one or even take it down on your phone. The reason I say this is because Surah Al-Fatiha is a surah that we pray every salah with. And so to understand this surah and what it means is vital for us. And to build a relationship with this surah is very important. And what I'm going to be mentioning here are valuable things for you. So inshallah ta'ala, starting with the following steps, inshallah ta'ala, the way that the lecture is going to be, or the lesson, is we're going to, number one, take, point number one, we're going to be taking Tafsir Surah Al-Fatiha. Meaning we're going to do Tafsir of it. Number two, inshallah. Number two, we're going to mention Fadailuha, the virtues of Surah Al-Fatiha. The second is the virtues. Number three is maqasiduha, the objectives of Surah Al-Fatiha. The objectives, maqasiduha. Number four, mawdu'atiha. Mawdu'atiha means the different topics it tackles. The different topics that Surah Al-Fatiha tackles. Five, balaghatul ayah. We're going to mention the balagha, the eloquency in this surah. Some of the eloquencies, we won't mention too much, but we're going to mention the eloquency in this surah. And last but not least, I'm going to conclude with masail al-fiqhiyah, some fiqh issues related to Surah Al-Fatiha. Some fiqh issues related to Surah Al-Fatiha that we need to know in fiqh, inshallah ta'ala. Before I go into Surah Al-Fatiha, I have to mention the Al-Istia'adah wal-Basmala. I'm going to mention the Istia'adah, which is A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, and the Basmala, which is Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Istia'adah, it is legislated to be recited before the Qur'an. The Istia'adah is legislated to be read before the Qur'an, meaning before you recite the Qur'an. And the Jumhur al-Ulama, the overwhelming majority of the scholars, are of the opinion. And Ibn Jarir al-Tabari has actually transmitted a consensus that is recommended. But I say it's not a consensus, it's a what? The view of the Jumhur, the overwhelming majority. And Ibn Jarir is not wrong by saying Ijma'. Why? Because ijma' to Ibn Jarir means the view of the overwhelming majority. So it's important you learn the terminologies of the scholars. So when you read Tafsir Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, and Ibn Jarir says, وَحُكِيَ الْإِجْمَاعُ فِي هَذِهِ الْمَسْأَلَةِ وَوَرَدَ فِي الْإِجْمَاعُ. He means ijma', the view of the majority of scholars. Because he himself says after that, وَخَالَفَ فِي ذَلِكَ, and so and so went against this opinion and this opinion. You just mentioned any consensus. For him, consensus, the word ijma' means, ijma' to Ibn Jarir al-Tabari means the view of the majority of the scholars. So isti'adah is highly recommended according to the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. So it's a recommended thing. And Allah Ta'ala, He said in the Quran, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ When you recite the Quran, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ Okay? فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ Now let's go a bit technical. فَاسْتَعِذْ is a command. And in the Arabic, in the Quran, the commands that come in the Quran, and also the commands that come in the Sunnah, they show obligation. فَاسْتَعِذْ Seek refuge in Allah. The ayah says, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ If you recite the Quran, فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Seek refuge in Allah from what? فَاسْتَعِذْ You're commanded. How can the jumhur of the ulama then say it's recommended? We'll come to that point. Write it down and remember it. Okay? We've mentioned two points so far. The first point that we mentioned is الاستعادة is مستحب. استعادة is recommended according to the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. The second mas'ala that we mentioned is that how do we respond to the how do we answer the statement of Allah Ta'ala where Allah says فاستعيد seek refuge in Allah. It's a command. When you're reading the Quran, Allah commanded us in this verse that we do isti'adah, and the commands in the Quran show what? Obligation. So there needs to be a response here. We can't just dismiss the ayah like that. Okay? We will respond to it, we'll come back to it. I'll come back to it later, because the evidence will come. The third point regarding the isti'adah, which is, what is the lafdul isti'adah? How do we say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim? Scholars are all different. Because the ayah just says, fasta'idh billah. How do we do isti'adah? قول الجمهور, the overwhelming majority of the scholars, they mention that لفظ الاستعادة is to say أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. Yes. Say it like that. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. قرطبي says this is the view of the جمهور. And inshallah ta'ala, we'll try to mention the view of the جمهور inshallah ta'ala, unless there's a delay that goes against it. So how many points have I mentioned so far? Three mas'ala. What was the first mas'ala? Isti'ada is recommended. Point number two? The Quran commands the isti'ada, and the overwhelming majority of scholars, they say what? It's mustahab. How do you reconcile between the two? Okay, that's no. Number three? The wording of an isti'ada. How do we say isti'ada? We say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitani ar-rajim, and this is the view of the what? Jumhur. Who said that this is the view of the Jumhur? Qurtubi, the great Mufassir. He is the one who said this is the view of the Jumhur. That's 3 points, right? Point number four. The scholars are unanimously in agreement. Unanimously. They mean ijma' of the ulama is that isti'ada laysat min al-Qur'an. Isti'ada is not from the Qur'an. It's not a verse from the Qur'an. It's not an ayah from the Qur'an. There is no difference of opinion amongst the scholars. So saying A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim doesn't mean you're reading what? An ayah from the Quran. Okay? That's the fourth point, which is Isti'adah Laysat Min Al-Qur'ani. It's not from the Quran, wala ayatan minhu. And it's not a verse from it. Okay? What does it mean, Isti'adah? Point number five. What does Isti'adah mean? It means Astajiru Wa Altaji'u بالمعبود الحق سبحانه وتعالى من كل جان متمرد مطرود عن كل خير. It means I seek refuge in Allah تبارك وتعالى. أعوذ بالله from who? من الشيطان. شيطان here is who? It means كل جان, every jinn who's متمرد, every jinn who is tyrannical, who's oppressive, who has gone against Allah تبارك وتعالى's command, I seek refuge in Allah تبارك وتعالى from it. From it. So what does it mean? It means I seek refuge. The word a'udhu, okay? A'udhu, it means astajiru wa altaji'u, it means I go back to, I run back to. Bil ma'bud al haq, the one who is deserving of worship. I run back to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who, from who? A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani. The shaitan here is what? The overwhelming majority of the scholars, they say, من الشيطان here means what? من الجان المتمرد. The jinn, that is what? That's tyrant. متمرد means goes against Allah's command and we seek refuge in Allah from it. it doesn't dismiss that it's also shayateen ul insi that we seek refuge in Allah from as well. Lakin the al-mutabadir ila al-dhihni, that which it runs to straight away when we say the shaytan, is what? The jinn. That's the one it runs to. We've understood that. If the isti'adah is not from the Qur'an, it's not an ayah from the Qur'an. Some of the scholars, they said, it is not recommend, it's not liked. It is not liked for the person to beautify their voice when they're reciting the isti'adah. Some scholars, they say that. And this is the view of the scholars who hold the opinion that you can only beautify your voice when it comes to the Qur'an. Because the isti'adah is not an ayah in kitabillahi, you do not beautify your voice with it. That is the view of the scholars who hold that the only thing that you can beautify your voice with is the Qur'an. Now we're going to mention five benefits in isti'adah. Five benefits, and we're going to move on from the isti'adah, and we're going to go to the basmala. The first benefit that we get from the isti'adah, or that is in the isti'adah, five benefits. Number one, al-iltija'u ila qadir yadfa'u al-afati 'anil 'abd. That there is one who has the ultimate power, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who can remove harm from the creation, especially when it comes to wasawisu shaytan, the whispers of shaytan. Shaytan strives very hard and puts all of his efforts in getting between us and what? Reciting the Qur'an. It's reading the speech of Allah. So before we even start, we're going to get rid of this. الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ. He whispers to us. He's going to say, don't read this much. Why do you want to read? Go play with your friends. Go do this, go do that. So what do you do? You get rid of him. Number two. The isti'adah is a purification of the mouth. From what? من اللغو والرفث. All of the indecent, inappropriate things that you said, the isti'adah, it purifies your mouth from this. And so, before you even say the word of Allah, your mouth is clean. Before you even recite a word from the Qur'an, you're cleaning your mouth from any impurities. Your mouth, the things that are inappropriate that you said, you're cleansing your mouth from it. And this is what Ibn Kathir rahimahullah mentioned. Number three, the angels, they come close to the individual who's going to read the Qur'an. The angels, they come close. And the introduction for that is what? The isti'adah. Isti'adah is an introduction for that. In other words, it's the introduction for a righteous action to come. Itself is a virtue. Number four. Isti'adah is only a unique, as the scholars mentioned, for the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you say A'udhu billahi min shaytanir rajim, you do not say after that except what? Except that you say the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the basmala, we're going to come to it inshaAllah ta'ala. When you seek refuge in Allah from it, you say and you recite after that Quran. ولذلك, the scholars, they do not legislate, the scholars do not allow anyone to say the isti'adah bayna yaday kalami ghayrihi, to a speech other than the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number five. Shaytan, he strives hard and he exerts every single effort to when the person intends to do good. Like Shaytan, this is what he does. And the person jumping to read the Qur'an is the actual, one of the greatest things that a person can utter with their mouth. This is the kalam of Allah. Because you are trying to do something very big, which is read Allah's words, and he doesn't even want you to do something very small from the good. Nasib al-qira'at al-isti'adah. It's beneficial to read the isti'adah. And I've seen it. If you read the isti'adah before reading the Qur'an, you tend to read more Qur'an than if you didn't. Are we all together? Now we're going to go into the basmala. The basmala is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Basmala, the basmala, what is it? The basmala, because it has in there things that are in Surah Al-Fatiha, we'll leave it in the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. Because it has in there Bismillah Allah. Ana ar-Rahman, Ana ar-Rahim. And three of the names, inshallah ta'ala, are going to come from Fatiha. But what I do want to mention from the basmala is the basmala ayatu min Surah Al-Fatiha? Is the basmala an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha? Fihi qawlan. There's two views. There are two views regarding whether the basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, is an ayah Surah Al-Fatiha. If you look at the Mus'haf, they adduhu ayah min Surah Al-Fatiha. They consider it to be a verse from Surah Al-Fatiha. So you see a number one with it, right next to it. What we say is, according to the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars, جمهور العلماء من الحنفية والمالكية والشافعية, no, شافعية is not there, الحنفية والمالكية والحنابلة وقول جمهور أهل المدينة. That is, and even the قراء, the overwhelming majority of the قراء, and the overwhelming majority of the فقهاء, and the Mufassirin, Ibn Jarir, Ibn Arabi, Ibn Atiyyah, Qurtubi, Ibn Taymiyyah, all of them, they hold the opinion that it is not, ليست البسملة آية من الفاتحة. That it's not a what? It is not a verse part of Surah Al-Fatiha. So I repeat, the Basmala is not a verse part of Surah Al-Fatiha. And I specifically say Surah Al-Fatiha. Say Surah Al-Fatiha. Because there are two places where the Basmala is part of the Quran. Sorry, there was one place by consensus of the scholars, sorry, that it's a what? I mean, the two places. Two places. In the Quran, that the basmala is a what? One is very direct, which is إِنَّهُ مِنْ سُلَيْمَانَ وَإِنَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ. That بِإِجْمَاعِ الْعُلَمَاء, by the consensus of the scholars, is مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ, it's from the Quran. That's one. And there's one place that the scholars unanimously agree that is not part of the Quran, which is before Surah Al-Bara'ah. Surah Al-Tawbah. Surah Al-Tawbah, before it, there's no basmala by consensus. And Surah Al-Naml, in it is a ayah, basmala is a part of it. As for it being an ayah from Surah Al-Fatiha, is the same argument for every other surah as well. Are we all together? But the strongest reason why they say Fatiha is because Fatiha is a rukun in the salah. So do I have to read it? If it's, that's why the argument is more stronger regarding Fatiha. So the view that's the strongest is that it's not a verse or part of Surah Al-Fatiha. This is the view of the جمهور العلماء من الحنفية والمالكية والحنابلة. And it's the view of أهل المدينة من القراء والفقهاء. And the مفسرين such as Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Al-Imam Ibn al-Arabi al-Maliki, Ibn Atiyyah Al-Qurtubi and Ibn Taymiyyah. Okay, those five from the Mufassirin. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Ibn al-Arabi, Ibn Atiyyah, Al-Qurtubi and Ibn Taymiyyah. Those five, they hold the opinion that it's not part of Surah Al-Fatiha. And they've got a strong evidence. And the evidence that they have is Hadith Abu Hurairah, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, قَسَمْتُ الصَّلَاةَ بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي نَصْفَيْنِ. I have divided the prayer between my slave and me into half. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, I divided the salah between me and my slave into two. And then look what he said, وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ, my slave will be given what he asks for. فَإِذَا قَالَ الْعَبْدُ, if the slave says, أَلْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. He didn't say the best. It started with what? Alhamdulillah. So, the scholars, they said, they said, فَلَوْ كَانَتِ الْبَسْمَلَةُ آيَةٌ مِنْ سُورَةِ الْفَاتِحَةِ لَوَرَدَتْ فِي هَذِهِ الرِّوَايَةِ مَعْدُودَةً ضِمْنَ آيَاتِهَا وَذَكَرَهَا كَمَا ذَكَرَ غَيْرَهَا. So Allah didn't mention it in the Fatiha, so it's not an ayah or part of it. Now we're going to go into Surah Al-Fatiha, inshallah ta'ala. Point number one regarding Surah Al-Fatiha. What is the name of Surah Al-Fatiha? What is the name of this surah? Write it down, inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to give you six names that are the names of Surah Al-Fatiha. Number one, it is called Fatihatul Kitab. It's called what? It is called Fatihatul Kitab. Number two is called Umm al-Quran. Number three is called Umm al-Kitab. Umm al-Kitab. Number four is called As-Sab' al-Mathani. It's called As-Sab' al-Mathani. And number five, it's called Al-Quran al-Azim. It's called Al-Quran al-Azim. And last but not least, it's called Surah al-Hamd. Those are the names that are being given to it. I'm going to mention some of them. The fact that it's called بفاتحة الكتاب. The evidence for that is the hadith of Ubadah ibn Samit. He said, I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There is no salah for the person who doesn't what? Who doesn't recite بفاتحة الكتاب. It was called what? بفاتحة الكتاب. So there's no prayer for that person. We're going to come back to revisit this hadith, inshallah, when we come to the issues of fiqh regarding this surah. The second evidence regarding the names of the surah is Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. The second hadith to prove the name of this surah is the hadith of our mother Aisha. May Allah be pleased with her and her father. She said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخفف الركعتين اللتين قبل صلاة الصبح. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he used to lighten alayhi salatu wasalam the two rak'ah before Salatul Subh, Salatul Fajr. Meaning the two sunnah before Fajr, he used to pray very lightly. Hatta inni la'akulu. Aisha said he will soften it and lighten those two sunnah to the extent I will say to myself, Hal qara bi umm al-kitab? Did he even recite umm al-kitab? So she referred to it as what? Umm al-kitab. ولذلك some of the scholars, they took from this, تسمية صور القرآن. The naming of the Quran is a مسألة اجتهادية وليست مسألة نصية. It's a مسألة based on اجتهاد, and it's not توقيفية. Meaning, some Sahabas used to give it, this name to one surah, and another Sahabi would give it to another. It was based on اجتهاد. The naming of the surah is, it wasn't taken, and other scholars they argue otherwise. And I've expanded on this issue when I was doing the sharah of the kitab Nuqaya من علم التفسير لجلال الدين السيوطي رحمه الله. Number three, the third evidence, Abu Huraira, he said that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, أم القرآن هي السبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم. So here were three names we got. أم القرآن, which is فاتحة, هي سبع المثاني. It is the seven that repeats itself. سبع المثاني means the seven that repeats itself. In the Surah Fatiha, how many verses? It's going to be tricky if we take the basmala out. How are we going to come with the seven? We'll see, inshallah ta'ala. Wal Quran al Azim, and it's also the Quran al Azim. لذلك it's powerful that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said to the Prophet, ولا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا به أزواج منهم زهرة الحياة الدنيا. أما ولا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا. Now in another ayah, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, Allah says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ لَا تَمُدَّنَّ عَيْنَيْكَ. صح. We have given you seven verses that repeat itself, Muhammad. We've given you Surah Al-Fatiha. Do not look at the worldly glamours and the glitters in the people's hands. How? Why would you want to look at what is in the people's hand if you have what? Surah Al-Fatiha. Imagine if you have more than Surah Al-Fatiha. The Muslim who only knows Surah Al-Fatiha has to realize he has better than this dunya and whatever is in it. The fourth evidence is Hadith of Abi Sa'id ibn al-Mu'alla. He said that مَرَّ بِي النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَأَنَا أُصَلِّي. He came by me and I was praying. فدعاني, he called me. He's praying. فدعاني, he called me. فلم آتيه, I never came to him. حتى صليت, until I finished the prayer. ثم أتيت فقال, then I came to the Prophet and I said, ما منعك, the Prophet said to me, what stopped you from coming to me? ما منعك أن تأتي, what stopped you from coming to me? فقلت, I then said, كنت أصلي, I was praying. Then the Prophet said to him, أَلَمْ يَقُلِ اللَّهِ, did Allah not say, يَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَلِلْرَسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. Did Allah not say, those of you who believe, if Allah and His Messenger call you to that which will give you life, then obey it. The scholars, they took from this verse that the salah, if a person is praying it and the Prophet ﷺ calls them, they need to leave the prayer. Like the salah stops and they come to what the Prophet said. That's what the scholars like Sirajuddin Bulqini took from the hadith. ثم قال, then the Prophet said to him, ألا أعلمك, shall I not teach you أعظم سورة في القرآن, shall I teach you the greatest surah in the Quran, قبل أن أخرج من المسجد, before I leave the masjid, shall I tell you it? He said, of course. He wants the knowledge, he loves it. He said, of course. فذهب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ليخرج من المسجد. The Prophet stood up to leave the masjid. After a discussion happened with him and some other companions, he forgot to tell the companion what he promised him. This again shows us that the Prophet is a human, he forgets. He doesn't know the unseen. He can forget, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. Huh? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet said, he stood up and he was about to leave. And as he was about to leave, فذكرته, I reminded him, I said, Ya Rasulullah, can you remember what you said to me? فقال, he then said to me, الحمد لله رب العالمين. هي سبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم الذي أوتيته. So it's the seven verses that repeat itself, and it's the great Quran Allah gave me. Surah Al-Fatiha. Then we took from there as well that it's called سبع المثاني والقرآن العظيم, and we also took from there the virtue of Surah Al-Fatiha as well. That is what? أعظم سورة في كتاب الله. It's the greatest surah. And what is the greatest ayah in the Quran? Ayatul Kursi. Ayatul Kursi is what? It's the greatest ayah in the Quran. And Surah Al-Fatiha is the what? Greatest surah in the Quran. The greatest surah in the Quran. So that's one of the virtues. Another virtue, a second virtue for Surah Al-Fatiha is, أعظم سورة في كتاب الله. It is the greatest surah in the Quran. That's the first virtue. Second virtue of Surah Al-Fatiha is أنها نور. It's light. And no prophet was given this light before Nabi Allah Muhammad. This is the only one. He was the only one given this. And the evidence for this is hadith of own noise. من فوقه, the Prophet heard from high above. فرفع رأسه, the Prophet raised his head. فقال, he then said, هذا باب من السماء فتح اليوم لم يفتح قط إلا اليوم. فنزل منه ملك فقال لم ينزل قط إلا اليوم. فسلم وقال أبشر بنورين هما نبي قبلك فاتحة الكتاب وخواتيم سورة البقرة لم تقرأ بحرف منها إلا أعطيته. Jibreel told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that noise that you can hear and that you've just heard, it's basically an angel that just descended, who's come to this earth. This angel has never ever come down before. First time he's ever coming down. And he has come with what? Recite a word of surah, these surahs, except that he will be given what he asks for. Third benefit. A question I have. How many people read Surah Al-Fatiha? Many, right? This hadith mentioned Allah Sirat al-Mustaqim, which is part of Surah Al-Fatiha. Yeah? How do we reconcile between that? If I get a chance, I'll answer it. If I don't, then you guys have to research it. You have to research. You have to learn to research. The third benefit. And know بقراءتي عن الله. And that is the hadith I mentioned before, where Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, قال الله تعالى حمدني عبدي وإذا قال if the person says الحمد لله رب العالمين Allah says he says حمدني عبدي my slave has praised me وإذا قال الرحمن الرحيم if the person says الرحمن الرحيم Allah تبارك وتعالى he says أثنى علي عبدي my slave has repeatedly praised me and when the person says مالك يوم الدين Allah تبارك وتعالى he says مجدني عبدي that my slave has some of the riwayat says فوض إلي عبدي my slave has passed over his affairs to me He's glorified me. And if the person says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ Allah then says, هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِي My slave, وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ And my slave will be given what he asks for again. He will be given what he asks for. And then when the slave says, إِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَالضَّالِّينَ Allah تبارك وتعالى, he says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلَ This is my slave, and my slave is So if he says إِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ he will get what he asks for. Then anyone who reads إِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ should be guided. How is that not the case? There is an answer to that. Number four, which is the fourth benefit, أَنَّوْ لَا صَلَاةِ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَ بِهَا The virtue of this surah is that if you do not recite it, there is no salah for you. You have to recite it. Based on the hadith that I recited before, I mentioned Ibn Samit, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لَا صَلَاةِ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ That there is no salah to the one who doesn't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Number five. أَنَّهَا رُقْيَةٌ شَافِيَةٌ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى Surah Al-Fatiha is a ruqya. And we all know the famous hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He said, إِنْطَلَقَ نَفْرٌ مِنْ أَصْحَابِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ A group of the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, they went out what? فِي سَفَرَةٍ سَافَرُوهَا They went on a journey. They traveled and they embarked on a journey. حَتَّى نَزَلُوا عَلَى حَيِّ مِنْ أَحْيَاءِ الْعَرَبِ Until they came to a village and a town. And فَاسْتَضَافُوهُمْ So they asked them to take them as guests. أَيُضَيِّفُوهُمْ And they said, we're not going to take you guys as guests. They refused. فَلُودِغَ سَيِّدُ ذَلِكَ That the chief of the people, he got bitten by a scorpion. A poisonous scorpion. Bit the chief of the village. فَسَعُوا لَهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ They tried everything, every medication, they tried to give it to him, but it didn't work. So they came to the companions who were there, who were refused, rejected. They felt their need to go to them. They went over to them and they said to them, يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّهْط الرَّهْط is نَفَرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ A group of people. They said, Ya ayyuhal nas, inna sayyidina ludig. He has been bitten by a scorpion, and we've tried everything for him. It doesn't seem to be working. Fahal indakum. Is it with you guys? Ama fahal inda ahadin minkum min shayt. Does anyone of you have anything to offer? Faqala ba'adhum na'am. Some of the riwayat mentioned, Abi Sa'id al-Khudri himself said, I have a solution. Wallahi inni la'aqi. He said, I can do ruqya for you. ولكن والله but by Allah I swear لقد استضافناكم we asked you guys to take us as guests فلم تضيفونا and you rejected us he said I'm not going to give it to you and because of that فما أنا براقل I'm not going to do رقية for you حتى تجعل لنا جعلا until you give us a what? A جعل and a جعل is ما يعطى على العمل that's basically a wage I'm not gonna, unless you give me wage From this hadith so far, what we understand is you can do ruqya on a non-Muslim. And the Sayyidul Qawm, he was a non-Muslim. Number one. That's what some of the riwayat. Number two. You can set a price if you do ruqya for someone. You can say, this is the price I take. Number three, you can only take money if your ruqya brings fruits. Like if the person gets cured, and if it doesn't, don't take nothing. 0-1. Are we all together? You're not allowed to charge when it's based on hours. Khata. The hadith has no delil in that. Are we all together?
No.
So you go to somebody and you say, Ruqya, when you get better, this is how much I want, okay? You both agree. The person gets better, healthy, is good. Give me what we agreed on. Are we all together? You give me what we agreed on. But I was reading on you for 2 hours and I need my 2 hour rate. This hadith is not evidence for it. Ala kulli hal, they recited on him and he got better. And when he got better, they took from him. And when they took from him, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, this is what happened. We did this. They did what they had knowledge of. And they said, Ya Rasulullah. Then the Prophet's first question he asked the companions is, وَمَا يُدْرِكَ أَنَّهَا رُقْيَةٌ. Who told you guys Fatiha is a ruqya? That it kills, because the Sahabi read Fatiha 7 times on the best. Only 7 times we recited Fatiha. And he got better. He said, well, how did you know Surah Al-Fatiha was a ruqya? That killed. He said to them, قَدْ أَصَبْتُمْ. What you guys did is perfect, it was good. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, وَضْرِبُوا لِي مَعَكُمْ سَهْمًا. Give me my portion. Give me my portion. Give me something as well. What you guys got, give me something from it. The scholars, they said that this is the reason why he... by the way, when the Prophet did that, فَضَحِكَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. He laughed. And he said, give me something. The reason is because, for 2 reasons scholars mentioned. And Ibn al-Qayyim is the one who extracted this. Number one, the reason why the Prophet said, give it to me is because أَنَا الَّذِي عَلَّمَكُمْ. I'm the one who taught you. And number two, which is the strongest, is that the Prophet did that because of them finding contentment in their heart, that the Prophet shared it with us. Because if he just says it, they may not still, but if he says, okay, I'll show you that it's fine, there's nothing wrong with this wealth that you got, I'm eating it, look at me, I'm taking it. Are we all together? Surah Al-Fatiha, we mentioned the benefits in it, right? We mentioned, how many benefits? 5 benefits. We stick to those 5 for everything. Surah Al-Fatiha, is it from the surahs that came down in before the Hijrah or after the Hijrah? And by the way, before the Hijrah is called Makki, and after the Hijrah is called what? Madani. Regardless of where it comes down. So if the Prophet migrated to Medina, but it came down in Mecca the day of Hajjat al-Wada, which was the Prophet was in Mecca, but it was after the Hijrah, it's called what? It's called Madani still. Even though it came down on Mecca. So the definition of Makki is Qabl al-Hijrah. Makki is Qabl al-Hijrah, before he migrated. And Madani is Ba'd al-Hijrah, after he migrated. Is Surah al-Fatiha Surah Makki or Surah Madaniyah? We say Surah al-Fatiha is a what? Surah Makkiyah. Nazalat Qabl al-Hijrah. It came down Qabl al-Hijrah. The evidence for that is Surah al-Hijr, which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala mentioned in it Surah al-Fatiha, which is وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ. According to the scholars, is what? Is a Meccan surah. Is what? Is a Meccan. And Surah al-Hijr being Meccan is ittifaq, ijma'. There's no difference of opinion. Are we all together? So if Surah al-Fatiha is mentioned in this ayah, Surah al-Hijr, this ayah being a Meccan surah is ijma' lakhtilafa fi. 2 scholars didn't differ on it. And what is mentioned here is what? Sab'a al-Mathani wal Quran al-Azim that we just mentioned. Are we all together? Then it means that it has to come down. Because the ayah says, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَاكَ, we gave you. The 7 verses that repeat itself and the Quran al-Azim. We gave it to you, Allah is saying. Then it had to have come down before this ayah. It had to have come down before this ayah. Some scholars who tried to, they said that this surah came down. And some of the Quran does, it came down more than once. So it came down in Mecca and it also came down in Medina. But the strongest is that it came down on Mecca, and It had to have come down in Mecca because of that ayah that we mentioned, وَلَقَدْ أَتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِ وَالْقُرْآنِ الْعَظِيمِ. And also the salah was made obligatory when? In Mecca, 3 years before the Prophet migrated. And the salah, what do you have to read in it? Surah Al-Fatiha. So it came down. Now I'm going to go into the objectives that are in Surah Al-Fatiha. What are the objectives of Surah Al-Fatiha? Okay. Number one is التعريف بالمعبود تبارك وتعالى. It's to explain to you and give you insight of who the Creator is, Allah تبارك وتعالى, the one who deserves to be worshipped. Who is He? The first objective of this surah is to explain to you who Allah تبارك وتعالى is. Number two is بيان طريق العبودية. It is to clarify to you the path of servitude. The second thing that this surah is going to do, it is going to clarify for you the path of servitude. The first one is التعريف بالمعبود تبارك وتعالى, and the second one is بيان طريق العبودية. It is to explain to you the path of servitude. Number three is بيان أحوال الناس مع هذا الطريق. The third objective of this surah is to clarify to you and to shed some light on the people, how they are in regards to that path, like the levels of people and the stages and the types of people when it comes to this path. We're gonna the types of people, and the types of people that are mentioned here are three, right? Al-Yahud, Al-Nasara, Wal-Ladina An'ama Allahu Alayhim. صح؟ الضالين من المغضوب عليهم أن الذين أنعم الله عليهم. And all three of them are in terms of that path, that sirat. Okay. That's in terms of the objectives that this surah wants to achieve after you've understood it. These are the four objectives that you take from this surah, that you leave. Surah wants to achieve from. But what does it discuss? Okay. What are the discussions that are happening in this surah? And the topics that it handles, this surah. What are the topics that it's handling? Which is موضوعاتها. It talks about Allah's characteristics and attributes. It talks about Allah's characteristics and what? Attributes. Surah talks about Allah's names and attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It also discusses and talks about Yawmul Akhirah, the Day of Judgment. So this is what it discusses. The Yawmul Akhir, the Day of Judgment. Number three, Ifradullah Ta'ala bil Ibadah, singling Allah in Ibadah. And that cannot be done. You cannot single Allah in Ibadah unless He aids you in that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He supports you in it. And unless you supplicate to Him. Those two. Number four, this surah discusses in it Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path. It talks about the straight path, that there is a straight path. It talks about it. And it contrasts between the two sirat. There are two sirats. Sirat in this dunya and the sirat of the Day of Judgment. And that the way you are on this sirat, if you are steadfast upon this sirat and you don't deviate from it, you're going to be steadfast upon that sirat and you're not going to fall from it. ولذلك ابن القيم rahimahullah, he says, look at how you are on the sirat of this world. When the Prophet said, وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِ مُسْتَقِيمًا فَاتَّبِعُوهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلَ فَتَفَرَّقَ بِكُمْ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ ذَلِكُمْ وَصَّاكُمْ بِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. When the Prophet sat down with his companions, he took a twig, a small little twig, he made a line on the earth, and he said, وَأَنَّ هَذَا سِرَاطِ, this is my path, فَاتَّبِعُوا. Hey, there's a path, and there's a sirat on this earth. And we were commanded to follow that sirat. And then the Prophet said, وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا السُّبُلُ, don't follow the other paths, the other sirat. What's going to happen? If you follow those paths, they're going to take you to Jahannam. They're going to take you to what? Jahannam and destruction. وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ. That sirat on this earth that we're all treading on right now, inshaAllah ta'ala, we hope Allah, He allows us to be on that path and keeps us on that path. That path, inshaAllah, we're going to see a bit about it, is a reflection of the sirat of the Day of Judgment and the way you're going to be on top of it. Okay, number five and last point that he talks about is the path. This surah discusses that the people are not all guided. You know, the fifth thing that he discusses is that the people are not all guided. And he talks about the guidance of the people are two types: extreme in exaggeration and extreme in negligence. The people are what? Extreme in exaggeration. They exaggerate and go overboard. And also they are extreme in what? And the path that Allah is pleased with is those who are in the middle. And we're going to talk about that inshallah ta'ala. Now, so far, we've done an introduction. Now we're going to go into the tafsir of Surah Al-Fatiha inshallah ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki yawmiddin, إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين إهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. There's a fifth issue we're going to mention later. Do you say آمين if you're not in salah or not? One of the fifth issues we're going to discuss later. But before I do the tafsir of the surah, there are two words which we want to explain. It's called the gharib al-alfad, strange words. Strange meaning, the reason why I'm calling it strange, is not very oftenly used like that to the non-Arabs before. The first word is Rabb. Here, it means As-Sayyid, Al-Malik. The word Rabb, it means the master. It means Al-Malik, the king and the ultimate king. And there's another word used here, which is as-sirat, and the word as-sirat means al-tariq, the path. Sirat means al-tariq. Now let's go to the ayah. The first verse, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he says, Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. The word alhamdulillahi, what does it mean? It means jami'u al-mahamidi lil-ma'budi tabaraka wa ta'ala. All praise is to Allah. That's what it means. No one is deserving of it, only Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Consistently and continuously, it's only for him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The word hamd, what does it mean? It means to describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with complete characteristics, with love, with veneration and glorification. The word hamd is used for the one who does you a favor, and it's also used for the one who is majestic and noble and high. It's also used for them, even if he doesn't do anything for you. So that's why the surah started with Alhamdulillah. The word Allah, brothers, is called Lafdhul Jalalah. And all of Allah's names go back to this name Allah. So in other words, what we say is, Allah is Ar-Rahman, but we don't say Ar-Rahman is Allah. We say Allah is Ar-Rahman, Allah is Al-Aziz, Allah is Al-Ghafoor. We say that, right? But we don't say Al-Ghafoor is Allah. Sahih. So it's all of the names go back to this one. They all go back to this name Allah. It is in this name Allah is Sifatul Uluhiyah, meaning the one who is worshipped alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who is deserving of worship alone. That's what it means. Now, brothers and sisters who are listening, pay attention to this. All of the names of Allah have characteristics in it, but not every characteristics is a name of Allah. Every name, there's a characteristics, a description and an attribute that is inside that name. But not every attribute and characteristics is a name. Are we all together? So, Ar-Rahman is a name and it's also characteristics. Allah is a name and it's also characteristics. Al-Aziz is a name and it's also characteristics. Every name, there's a characteristics in it. But not every characteristics is a name of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. You don't give it to him as a name. Are we all together? Does that make sense? So based on that, the characteristics are going to be more than the names. The characteristics are going to be more than the names. Good. So Allah, we have so far, the word Allah has been used here. Alhamdulillahi, we've taken the word Allah. Now we're going to move on to the word رب العالمين. We took the word رب means what? The master, al-malik, the king, رب العالمين. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he controls and he runs the whole entire universe. He runs it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The word alameen, it means samawat wal-ard wa ma baynahuma. What's the evidence for that? That the word alameen, it means the samawat. It means the ard. And anything in between it, what's the evidence for it? The statement of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, qala fir'aun wa ma rabbul alameen. What did Musa say? قال رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما إن كنتم موقنين. He said to him. When Fir'aun asked, قال فرعون وما رب العالمين. What is this رب العالمين you're talking about? Because he thought to himself that Musa was going to say, oh, you're the رب العالمين to Fir'aun. But Nabi Allah Musa instead said what? When he said, who is رب العالمين? Nabi Allah Musa said to him, he said to him, قال رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما. The Lord of the Samawat and the Ard and that which is in between it, in kuntum muqinin, if you are certain about what I'm saying, Surah Shu'ara. So we learned that the word alameen means what? The Lord of the Samawat and the Ard and everything between it. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, they are two names of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. They are what? Two names. These two names, the scholars have had an ongoing discussion regarding it. The characteristics of Allah are divided into two. The characteristics of Allah, the scholars, Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, divide the characteristics of Allah into two. Sifat that they call sifat datiya. Sifat datiya are characteristics that are connected to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always and every time. Knowledge, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has always had knowledge, always will have knowledge. Sifat datiya doesn't detach itself whenever he wants. There's a characteristics, but it's connected to his will. It happens when he wants it to happen. Are we all together? The scholars, they said, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim. Are they sifa datiya? Are they both sifa fi'liya? Or is one datiya and one is fi'liya? A discussion. Life. So sifa connected to him alone. Like sifa fi'liya are things that he, and Ar-Rahim is what? Sifa fi'liya. That's one view. That's one view. A second view is both of them are sifa fi'liya. And then what's the difference then? Because we know both of these names, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, are taken from the characteristics Ar-Rahman. It's taken from Ar-Rahman. But what is the difference then? The difference they said is that Ar-Rahman is Ar-Rahmat al-Wasi'ah. It's the vast mercy. It's Ar-Rahmat to everybody, the Muslim, the non-Muslim, it doesn't matter. That's Ar-Rahman. And Ar-Rahim is only to the believers. It's called Ar-Rahmat al-Musila. And that's why Allah said, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ Rahim, not what kind of Mumineen Rahmana. He used the word Rahim for them. So for the believers, Rahim, and for the disbelievers, Rahman. That's when we say that they're both what? Sifa fi'liya. That's the hardest discussion today we're going to have. Don't worry, inshallah. We're not going to go into that technicality anymore. Some of you guys got confused slightly. But it's important to learn these characteristics of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, to have understanding of your Lord. Walillahi al-asma'ul husna. فَدْعُوهُ بِهَا وَذَرُوا الَّذِينَ يُلْحِدُونَ فِي أَسْمَائِهِ Allah has the names and attributes. It's important to know your creator, Allah. Then Allah says, مَالِكِ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ What does it mean, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ First of all, the qira'at that have come regarding مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ is two ways of reciting it. You can say, مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ and you can say what? مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ Those are the two qira'at. There are what? They are the two different recitations. So when we say Maliki is bil alifi, which is has med on it. Bil alifi medda. Are we all together? What does it mean when you say Maliki? It means al-mamluki lahu, the owner of everything. That's what it means. So when you say Maliki yawmiddin, it means the what? The owner of everything. But when you say Maliki, it means الأمير والناهي للأشياء The one who commands and prohibits things. Which both come to the same meaning. The owner of everything has the rights to command it and prohibit it. Are we all together? So this is both two meanings that complement one another. But there's no contradiction in the Quran. ولذلك when Allah تبارك وتعالى He said in the Quran, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. That if this Quran was to come from other than Allah, you would find what in it? Like a lot of contradiction. It means that the Quran, not one qira'ah will not affirm what the other qira'ah will reject. It won't happen. There can be differences in wordings in some of the qira'at, but they complement one another. They give additional meaning to one another, but they don't go against each other. The ayah said that they don't contradict one another. They didn't say that there's no differences. There can be differences in the recitation of the Quran, but there can't be contradiction. And of course, those recitations that have come from the Prophet, all of them have come from it. Rasulullah read it as He, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, is the one who owns and possesses the Day of Judgment, and He also commands and prohibits that day. What does He do? He commands that day. No one else is able to. Everyone is weak. That's why Allah says, لِمَنُ الْمُلْكُ الْيَوْمُ لِلَّهِ وَاحِدِ الْقَهَارِ. But question, why did Allah say مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ? Is He not the king of this dunya as well? The reason is because the dunya people might argue and I The balagha of the language, mashallah. So iyyaka is a maf'ul bi. Muqaddam is being put forward. It was meant to be, in according to the normal standard Arabic language, is na'budu iyyaka. Huh? That's how it's meant to be. But here it became what? Iyyaka na'budu. The reason why the iyyaka came before na'budu is a meaning that comes out of it, which is known as what? Al-hasr, exclusivity. The qa'ida is taqdeemu ma haqquhu ta'khir yufidu al-hasr. Like this word iyaka should have been back. It got put forward. It shows exclusivity, meaning only you, O Allah, we worship. That's what the meaning that comes out of it now. But if you said na'budu iyaka, means Allah, we worship you. But when you said iyyaka na'budu, you're saying what? Only you, Allah, we worship. ولذلك then it's wrong after you prayed Fatiha, you recite Surah Al-Fatiha and you read the... Then you go and you call unto the awliya and you go to the graves and you beg them and you just said iyyaka na'budu. It's wrong. You just haven't understood what you're reciting. Iyyaka na'budu, you alone, O Allah, we worship. Wa iyyaka, and you alone, O Allah, we seek what? Help from, right? Last lesson, we took the word ibadah, iyyaka na'budu, na'budu is ibadah, right? We took in our sharh of la ilaha illallah, that the word ibadah is ismun jami'un li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yardahu min al-aqwali wal-a'mali al-zahirati wal-batina. Sah? It's a general term for everything Allah loves and is pleased with in terms of speech and action, external or internal. Question here. Is isti'ana ibadah based on this definition? Isti'ana is a ibadah. Hey, why was it taken out of Iyyaka Na'budu? Why was it independently mentioned? Was it Iyyaka Na'budu wa Iyyaka Nasta'in? If Nasta'in is part of Ibadah, what's the reason of separating them from each other? Who's ever thought of that question? Isti'ana is a Ibadah. We all agree, right? Isti'ana, asking Allah for help, is a Ibadah, right? But Allah already said Ibadah. He said Iyyaka Na'budu. And again, he said, وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. It's common in the Quran. It's عَطْفُ الْخَاصِ عَلَى الْعَامِ. It's known as. It's common in the Arabic now, Quran. And it's, Arabs use that as well. مَكَانَ عَدُوَّ لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَرُسُلِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَالَ. Is Jibreel and Mikael not from the angels that were mentioned? وَالْمَكَانَ عَدُوَّ لِلَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَجِبْرِيلَ وَمِيكَالَ. Jibreel and Mikael, why were they taken out of the angels? Because they're not like the rest of the angels. Nasta'in was taken out of ibadah because ibadah cannot happen without isti'ana, for Allah helping you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't do it by yourself. You should never think to yourself you can. So because of its importance, it was mentioned. Does that make sense? Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Oh Allah, in you we seek help and aid. We do. Okay. Here, I want to go back to a point, which is Allah mentioned Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, and then after what did He say? Why did Allah mention Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim and then Malik Yawm al-Din? The fawaid and the benefits that the scholars mentioned is because the ayah just mentioned Allah is most merciful and most gracious. The person might just have hope. To put fear in him, Allah says, Malik Yawmiddin. Which is to what? To also to be scared. He's scared. This is the way that we Muslims live our lives. We're hopeful and we're fearful. And not one overcomes the other. Okay? We're scared of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala and we hope from Him. We don't fall extreme in either. Malik Yawmiddin. Here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He mentions Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim after that. When He says, Iyaka na'budu, to you, O Allah, you alone we worship. Before I move on to that again, sorry. Why was Iyaka na'budu mentioned after Malik Yawmiddin? Everywhere. Every ayah has a relationship with the ayah before it. There's a munasaba bayna al-ayat, and you have to learn that. Especially if you're trying to memorize the Quran, it will help you. The day of judgment, the people who are going to be successful are those who worship Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Malik Yawmiddin, Iyyaka na'budu, to you Allah, O Allah, alone we worship. Since you're the king of that day, and no one else can control it. And that day, the only people who are going to make it through that day is those who worship you alone. Iyyaka na'budu, you alone we worship. No one else is going to make it that day, Yawm al-Qiyamah. Because the disbelievers that day are not going to receive anything from Allah. That's why Allah said, إِنَّ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارُ وَمَا لِلظَّالِمِينَ مِنْ أَنْصَارٍ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَنْ يُشْرَكَ بِهِ وَيَغْفِرُ مَا دُونَ ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. A mushrik who didn't do ibadah for Allah alone is going to lose out that day. That's why we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. But then the question here is, ibadah in what way? How do we do ibadah? Ibadah is the ultimate goal, is the objective and the purpose of our life, right? But it has a path. That's why we say, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim. Ibadah is the ultimate goal. Before you go to the goal, you have to take a route, right? The route is what? As-Sirat. Guide us on that path, oh Allah. Put us on that path. Are we all together? The people that are on that path are three types of people. People who's on the straight path and they went straight and they didn't look right or left and they are consistent upon it. And the people who put their leg on the path and they went right and left. Who are they? Because the roads are very scary. If you come to a road, you're like, whoa, and you don't know what direction to go. What are you going to do? You're just going to go to the wrong direction. So we're begging Allah, Ya Allah, put on the one that's going to get us to your ibadah. The one that's going to lead you to it. Well, look at subhanAllah, another ayah, Allah says, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ. Obey Allah and what? Who are these people who worship Allah? وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ. Anyone who obeys Allah and the Messenger. فَأُولَيْكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَيْكَ رَفِيقًا. This ayah told us, obey Allah and His Messenger. Obeying Allah and His Messenger, you need friends to do this with. There are people who need to accompany you. There are people you need to follow their footsteps. And who are these people? This other ayah explained it to you. And who is it? من النبيين. Who was mentioned after the Nabiyeen? Siddiqeen. Who is the Siddiq of this Ummah? This is the ayah some of the scholars took from Abu Bakr, is deserving of prophets and khilafah after the Prophet Nabi Muhammad. Because Allah says, Minan Nabiyeen are the prophets. And right after the Prophet is mentioned. And who is the Siddiq of this Ummah? Abu Bakr. So Abu Bakr was given the position. ولذلك Al-Allama Muhammad Al-Amin Shaqiti used to say, Abu Bakr's khilafah is mansoosul fil Quran. Abu Bakr's khilafah is stated in Surah Al-Fatiha. Are we all together? Because Allah says, Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim. Sirat al-Ladina an'amta. An'amta is general here. Who were the ones who Allah had bestowed His blessings on? In Surah Maryam, Allah explained, Surah Nisa, Allah explained to us, who are they? Min al-Nabiyyina, wa-Siddiqina, wa-Shuhada'i, wa-Salihin, wa-Hasuna, wa-Laika, wa-Fiqa. Who are the people, brothers, who go against this path? There are two people. The first ones are called Maghdubi Alayhim. Maghdubi Alayhim are who? Al-Yahud. In the Quran, if you look at the Quranic discourse, you tend to find the Yahud are the ones who are referred to as Maghdubi Alayhim. Allah says in an ayah, مَلْعَنَهُ اللَّهُ وَغَضِبَ عَلَيْهِ. Then he's referring to the who? The Yahud. Those Allah cursed, and he became what? And they're angered for them. فَبَاءُوا بِغَضَبٍ عَلَى غَضَبٍ. Allah تبارك وتعالى, he mentions غضب for who? مغضوب غضب is used for the Yahud. ولذلك حديث عدي بن حاتم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has done tafsir of this ayah. The Prophet specifically said, Al-Maghdubi, Yahud. Wal-Dhalin, he said, is what? Al-Nasara. And the Nasara, if you look at the Quranic discourse, Allah refers to them as what? Dhalin. Especially in Surah Al-Ma'idah, when Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala mentioned their statement and their description of Isa ibn Maryam and the concept of Trinity, Allah says, قَدْ ضَلُّوا مِنْ قَبْلُ وَضَلُّوا كَثِيرًا وَضَلُّوا عَنْ سَوَئِ السَّبِيلِ. So, Balal is a lot of the times is used for the Nasara. And Al-Maghdubi Alayhim is used for who? Summarize now. These two parties and the ones that made it, what is the difference between them? The difference between them is the Jews, Alimu walam ya'malu. They had the knowledge, but they didn't implement it. The Jews, they know. They had people of knowledge amongst them. Alimu, they had the knowledge. وَلَمْ يَعْمَلُوا بِهِ, they didn't implement it. وَأَمَّا النَّصَارَى عَمِلُوا وَلَمْ يَعْلَمُوا. They acted without no knowledge. The ones who made it, what did they do? جَمْعُ بَيْنَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْعَمَلِ. They combined between knowledge and what? Are we all together? They combined between what? Beneficial knowledge and what? Action. Pay attention to that. And those are the two things that every single one of us has to nurture every day of your life. You wake up in the morning, beneficial knowledge, righteous action. Next day again, benefit more knowledge, more righteous action. The more your knowledge increases, the actions increase with it. Mark increase. You live your life ticking off the increasing of your knowledge and your action. Both of them. Are we all together? Question. This is a benefit. What is the bare minimum of knowledge I need to have? What is the bare minimum of righteous action that I need to have? You know what he said, Ibn al-Qayyim? He said the bare minimum of knowledge is that which brings about certainty. Al-yaqeen brings about certainty. That you don't have shak of your religion. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. That you don't have doubt. It removes doubt. That's the bare minimum of knowledge you need to have. And what is the bare minimum of action that you need to have? As-sabr, patience. And Allah says in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا لَمَّا وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. The bare minimum, if the ummah come with, Allah promised them he's going to make them leaders. Are we all together? بِالصَّبْرِ وَالْيَقِينِ تُنَالُ الْإِمَامَةِ فِي الدِّينِ. With patience and certainty, you become a leader. Because Allah said, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. We made them leaders. وَلَكِنْ لَمَّا صَبَرُوا. When they came with patience, وَكَانُوا بِآيَاتِنَا يُوقِنُونَ. And when they came with what? Certainty of our religion. The bare minimum, if Ummah Muhammad come with it today, the dunya, the whole entire world will be put in their hands. Allah has promised us that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Are we all together? It's a solution for the Ummah. Let alone if they increase in knowledge and if they excel in righteous action, the bare minimum of yaqeen, which is certainty, and a sabr, if they come with it, Allah promises, like He promised for the previous nations, leadership. And so, this is one course that can be done, like what the concept of leadership in Islam and how to attain it. There is great books written regarding it. Now, inshallah ta'ala, I'm going to go into the last chapter of today's session, inshallah ta'ala, that I'm going to mention, and that is Al-Masail Al-Fiqhiyya Al-Mutaalliqati Bi Surah Al-Fatiha. Fiqh issues related to Surah Al-Fatiha, I'm going to mention them inshallah ta'ala. Number one. So, fiqh issues related to Surah Al-Fatiha. The first one is, what is the ruling in reciting Fatiha in the Salah, whether you are an Imam or you're alone? Okay, you are alone, you're praying by yourself, or you're an Imam and you're leading the people. What is Surah Al-Fatiha? Do you have to read it? Do you not? Reciting Surah Al-Fatiha in the Salah, whether you are an Imam or whether you are munfarid alone, it's a pillar from the Salah which you have to read. It's a rukun. A rukun, it's a pillar. Whether you're the leader and you're the imam, or whether you're the ma'moom, the one that's been led, you have to recite it. وَهَذَا مَذْهَبُ الْجُمْهُورِ This is the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. مِنَ الْمَالِكِيَةِ وَالشَّافِعِيَّةِ وَالْحَنَابِلَةِ وَجُمْهُورِ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ مِنَ الصَّحَابَةِ وَالتَّابِعِينَ وَمَنْ بَعْدَهُمْ It's the view of the majority of scholars. And the evidence for that is the hadith of who? عُبَادَةَ بْنُ صَابِتٍ لَا صَلَاةَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِفَاتِحَةِ الْكِتَابِ There is no prayer for the one who doesn't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Second question. The second mas'ala fi al-qiyam, which is reciting Surah Al-Fatiha for a salah where the recitation is loud. The imam is reading it loud. It's salah which is known as salah jahriya. It's maghrib, isha, or fajr. The imam is reciting loud. We know that the imam must read it. He has no choice. It's a pillar for him. The question here is the one who is praying behind the imam. Does he also have to read it? Or is the recitation of the imam a recitation for him? The opinion of the scholars is two. There's two views amongst the scholars. One view is, the first view, is that it's not obligatory to read Surah Al-Fatiha if you're praying behind an imam who's reciting it loudly in Salat Al-Jahriya. Rather, they say that it's obligatory for you to listen to him because of the ayah وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ Be quiet and listen to the recitation of the imam. This is the view of the Jumhur al-Ulama, the overwhelming majority of scholars. من الحنفية والمالكية والشافعية والحنابلة And also it's the old opinion of Imam al-Shafi'i. Imam al-Shafi'i has two opinions, قول القديم and قول الجديد. And the قول القديم, if you hear it, is the قول he had when he was in Iraq. And the ones who, how do we know his قديم قول from his جديد قول? We look at who transmitted this view. If the students of his that were in Iraq transmitted, like Al-Hassan ibn Muhammad al-Za'farani, Abu Thawr, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and others like that transmitted, then it's قول القديم. Huh? It's the old opinion. But if it's transmitted in Egypt from Al-Rabi' ibn Sulaiman al-Muradi, Ismail ibn Yahya al-Muzani, Abu Ya'qub al-Buwayti, and others, then this is قول الجديد. Is considered to be what? Al-Qul al-Jadid. Shafi'i in his Qul al-Jadid, he believes it's obligatory to recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Al-Imam Shafi'i in Qul al-Jadid, he believes, Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'a, he believes that you have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha for the Salawat al-Jahriya. Wa huwa al-Qul al-Rajah. And that's the strongest opinion. That you must recite, Surah Al-Fatiha, even if it's been recited loudly. Everyone has to recite it. Because of that hadith, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. Okay? Good. And we are Shafi'iyah, right? In this country. This is one of the things I like about this country. The people are what? Right? So, قول الإمام, the Imam of our madhab, what did he say? Our recite is obligatory. And it's strong. The poet, he said, أَنَا شَافِعِيُّ مَا حَيِّتُ I'm a Shafi'i for as long as I live. فَوَصِيَّتِي لِلنَّاسِ أَن يَتَشَفَعُوا My advice to the people is to be all Shafi'is. So, that is the strongest opinion, that you recite it. Because the hadith is صَحِيحٌ صَرِيحٌ صَحِيح is authentic and صَرِيح is direct. And Imam Al-Bayhaqi, the great Shafi'i jurist, had a Rithal on this, two volume. And Imam al-Bayhaqi, anyone who reads that is enough. Are we all together? If you read that kitab and you really read it, and you, it's a very good kitab. It's a what? It's a very good kitab. المسألة الثالثة, the third مسألة, which is الخطأ في قراءة الفاتحة, a mistake in reciting سورة الفاتحة. What about if a person does a mistake in reciting Surah Al-Fatiha? If a person changes the order of the ayah, the mistake is He changes the order. Okay? He says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ. He changed the order. If a person changes the order, or he changes a letter with another letter, are we all together? Or he recites a word so bad that it changes the meaning. Changes the meaning. That salah of that person is not sahih, and he needs to repeat it. وَهُوَ مَذْهَبُ الشَّافِعِيَّةِ. This is Shafi'i madhab. وَالْحَنَابِلَ and حَنَابِلَةِ madhab. وَقَوْلُ لِلْمَالِكِيَّةِ. And it's a view within the Maliki madhab. And it's the view chosen by Sheikh ibn Baz ibn Uthaymeen. Okay? المسألة الرابعة. The fourth مسألة. حكم إبدال الضاد في قوله تعالى. The word ضاد. The person said ولد ضالين ضالين. So he changed the word ضالين into a ضاد. Not a ذال but a ضاد. Okay? What happens? Reciting Surah Al-Fatiha, he did that mistake. تصح صلاة من أبدل الضاد في الآية بالذاء. No problem. And it's not good, but his salah is still sahih. And this is the goal of majority of the Hanafiya. It's the most common view. It's the most common view in the Hanbali madhab. And also the Aqwal al-Malikiyya, and it's a wedge, it's a view in the Shafi'i. Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Kathir, Ibn Baz, Ibn Uthaymeen, and others, this is the opinion they took. Number five. حكم الاقتداء بإمام يلحن في الفاتحة إذا كان اللحن في الفاتحة يغير المعنى. Pray behind an imam who's reciting Fatiha to the extent that the meaning is changing the way he's reading it. He's reading it so badly that it's actually changing the meaning of Surah Al-Fatiha. It is not permissible to pray behind an imam who is doing lahan in Fatiha. And he's doing a mistake so severe that it's changing the meaning, you're not allowed to pray behind him. وهو مذهب الشافعية والحنابلة وقول للمالكية. You shouldn't pray behind him. Because the salah between that person's salah is batil. So فلا يصح الاقتداء به. Don't pray behind someone like that. Number six. Point number six, inshallah ta'ala, which is praying behind an imam if the mistake that he's doing is not changing the meaning. His mistake, the imam's doing mistakes, but it's not changing the meaning. It's disliked. It's disliked to pray behind him. If he's doing mistakes in Surah Al-Fatiha, the mistakes are not changing the meaning. The salah behind him is correct, and is the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars, Al-Hanafiyya, Al-Shafi'iyya, Al-Hanabila, Waqulu lil-Malikiyya. And some scholars even transmitted an ijma', like Ibn Mazah in his Kitab Al-Muhit Al-Burhani, Nawawi in Kitab Al-Majmu', which is a sharah of Al-Muhaddab Ibn Ishaq Al-Shirazi, Al-Kashaf Al-Qanna' by Buhuti, Mawahib Al-Jalil by Ibn Hattab, and others. They transmitted an ijma' that you can pray behind him, but it's disliked. It is disliked. Number seven, repeating Surah Al-Fatiha in one rak'ah more than once. This is not legislated. So what do I mean by that? Remember, we can read Surah Al-Fatiha and then another surah after it. The best is, I want to read Fatiha again. So I want to read Fatiha twice. I love this surah. أَعْظَمُ آيَةِ سُورَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ. It's the greatest surah in the Quran. I want to repeat it twice. We say this is not legislated. It's not legislated to do that. Without a reason. There's a reason, which is what? The person read it and they did a mistake, and they felt that there was a mistake that when they did it, and they finished, and they felt, you know what, that's not Fatiha. Then he recited again, and he read it, this is Shay Akhar. But we're talking about someone who wants to just, instead of picking somewhere from the Quran, he repeats Fatiha twice. This is not permissible. This is the view of the overwhelming majority of scholars. The Hanafiyya, the Malikiyya, the Hanabila, that's what they believe. And what we say is, if there's khayr in it and there was good in it, the Salaf, the pious predecessors, will precede us in this action. This is an ibadah. Number eight, the salah of a person who is unable to read Fatiha. There's a person here who can't read Surah Al-Fatiha. What should we do? If the person is an ummi, لا يقرأ ولا يكتب, he can't read or write, and he's become old, مثلا, he took Islam at a very old age, can't memorize anything, We won't remember it. What do we do with that person? We say for salatu sahiha. If he prays the salah without fatiha, his salah is sahih. Because he hasn't got the ability to do so. And the evidence for this is an ijma'. Consensus. There's no difference of opinion amongst the scholars. And the consensus of the scholars is a proof. And Allah tabaraka ta'ala, he says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. But he hasn't got the ability. He's an old 80-90 year old, took Islam. He can't learn fatiha. He doesn't know how, can't memorize it. That's number nine. What does that person do? Number nine is, if he can't read Fatiha, what does he do? So he hasn't got the ability to memorize Surah Fatiha, then he's too old. So what does he do? If he's managed to memorize seven other verses in any other place in the Quran, then he exchanges that with Fatiha. Seven verses. That's the first option. If he doesn't, and this is the madhab al-Shafi'iyah. Shafi'iyah believe that the person recites seven ayat from the Quran, wherever it may be, that he knows. He reads that in the place of Fatiha. The second view is, no, what he does is that he does adhkar. Any dhikr he can do. Subhanallah, 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 subhanallah. Just say that while he's standing. Subhanallah, 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 subhanallah. Keep saying that. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Keep saying that. And then he does ruku'. And the evidence for that is the hadith of Rifa'at ibn Rafi'i. That the Prophet ﷺ, he said, hadith found in Abu Dawood. The Prophet, he said, قُمْتَ إِلَى صَلَاتِ فَتَوَضَّعْ كَمَا أَمَرَكَ اللَّهُ ثُمَّ قُمْ فَاسْتَقْبِلِ الْقِبْلَةَ ثُمَّ كَبِّرْ فَإِنْ كَانَ مَعَكَ قُرْآنٌ فَقْرَأْهُ. The Prophet said, if you have Quran with you, read it. And then after when he said, وَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ مَعَكَ قُرْآنٌ, and if you don't have no Quran with you, فَأَحْمَدِ اللَّهَ, say Alhamdulillah, وَهَلِّلْهُ وَكَبِّرْهُ. Just say tahleel, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. The tenth mas'ala, inshallah ta'ala, which is, what does it mean reciting Surah Al-Fatiha? Does it mean in salawat which are sirriya, like it's not loud? It's not Maghrib, it's not Isha, and it's not Fajr. What does it mean to recite it? It means, brothers, that your lips move. The Arabs do not consider recitation this. And no lips moving. If you're reading Fatiha or any surahs from the Quran, your lips are moving. Okay? But it's not a condition that you hear it. You hearing it is not a condition. A person can read it, and if no one can hear it, nor can he hear it, it's not a condition. Like if the movements of the lips is a what? It's a condition. Recitation to them is that the lips are moving. Number 11. At-ta'minu fi salah. Saying ameen in the salah. It's a sunnah recommended. It's a what? It's a recommended sunnah. Highly recommended. It's not wearing people. If the salah is a salah where the volume is low, dhuhr, asr, then what do you do? Of course your ameen is going to be low. And if it's salah jahriya, you say it loud, with the imam. You say what? The imam. إذا قال الإمام ameen, you say what? You say ameen with him. Na'am. And there's no other place. This is the view of the overwhelming majority of the scholars and عامه اهل الحديث. اذا امن الامام فامنوا فانه من وافق تامين تامين الملائكه غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Number 12. What about ameen outside the prayer? So I read Fatiha right now to a group of brothers. What about saying ameen outside the prayer? Huh? What is the issue? It's recommended to say ameen even if it's outside the prayer. It is recommended to do it, whether you're praying or not. And this is the madhhab al-a'immah al-arba'ah: Abu Hanifa, al-Imam Malik, al-Imam Shafi'i, and al-Imam Ahmed. This is the madhhab of the four imams. It's the view that Ibn Baz mentioned, rahimahullah ta'ala, and the evidence is the hadith that we mentioned was restricted to the salah, right? But there's another hadith where the Prophet said, إِذَا قَالَ أَحَدُكُمْ, if one of you says, Ameen, وَقَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ فِي السَّمَاءِ Ameen, فَوَافَقَتْ إِحْدَاهُمَ الْأُخْرَى غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِ. They said this was genuine. This hadith shows that it was not restricted to the prayer. Because this hadith doesn't say, إِذَا قَالَ الْإِمَامُ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. This one is general. So with this one, it says, إِذَا قَالَ أَحَدُكُمْ, if one of you says. So you can say whatever. So they said this hadith is general. Number 13, and it's the last one, which is, where does the person... No, this is another point I want to go back to before. 13 is going to be something else. But there's one point I want to go back to. If I said before that you have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, what do you have to do? You have to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, even if it's Maghrib, Isha, and what? Fajr. The question is, where do I recite it? I have to recite it. It's not from the Sunnah for the Imam to be silent between the two recitations of the two different surahs. Are we all together? The hadith and the evidence regarding the breathing and the silence there, there's no authentic evidence for it. The Imam, if he says, وَلَضَّالِينَ, and the people, Ameen, and he's reads straight away. The silence here, there's no evidence for it. Are we all together? So where do I say the Fatiha then? If that's been eliminated, that was my only chance. And now you've taken that from us, what do? You recite with the Imam. What do? When he's reciting Fatiha, you recite it with him. So you say Alhamdulillah, you say Alhamdulillah, Ya Rabbila. You recite it with him. He's reading Fatiha high and you're reading with him. You're both reciting it together. Does that make sense? Pay attention here. Pay attention here, which is, what about if I came to the salah late now, which brings me to the 13th point. And I missed the Imam's recitation of Fatiha. For example, I came and he read Fatiha already and he's maybe in another surah. What do? You come in and you read your own Fatiha, no problem. That's easy. You're standing, he's got another surah he's in, you say Allahu Akbar and you read your Fatiha. But the question here is, if you meet him in ruku' and you said that Fatiha is a rukun, a pillar, what do we do here? The strongest opinion that I hold is the view of Imam al-Bukhari and the noble companion of Abu Huraira, is that salah from the ruku' is not valid. You don't consider that rak'ah because of Fatiha. So if you come into the ruku', you have to repeat that rak'ah if you didn't read Fatiha. There is another opinion that they say, based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَدْرَكَ الْإِمَامُ رَاكِعًا فَقَدْ أَدْرَكَ الرَّكْعَةَ. Anyone who meets and reaches the Imam in the state of ruku' has caught that rak'ah. There are some scholars who push that argument and they say that's the way forward. And they are those, by the way, those who are saying that as well, are the ones who say reciting Fatiha is obligatory and it's a pillar. But they say when the ruku' comes, it's an exception now. You see, there are some who say that. And of course, those who didn't believe it was a rukun anyways in Salatul Jahriya, their issue is what? You don't. There's no problem for them. Ala kulli hal, my argument is that لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There is no salah for you if you don't read Fatiha. It's a rukun. It's a pillar. And the pillar must be come with. لذلك, the pillar is wajib. وَيَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهِ بُطْلَانُ الْعَمَلِ إِنْ فُقِدَ. It's an issue with shart, right? And a rukun. Shart and a rukun are both obligatory, but their absence makes that action null and void. That's what their job is. If something is a condition and you don't come with it, the action is null and void. You didn't do it, it's null and void. And if that thing is a pillar and you don't come with it, the action is null and void, and you're a sinner as well, because you left the wajib. Like in wajibatul salah, if you leave it, you're a sinner, but not the action is still, you don't have to repeat it. It's not batil. Are we all together? So the Fatiha is a ruknun min arkan salah. Is a what? Ruknun min arkan salah. Just repeat that rak'ah, inshallah ta'ala, and bring it back. That's inshallah ta'ala what I intended for today's class, inshallah ta'ala. I hope you benefited from it and have a good understanding of Surah Al-Fatiha. Anything that I said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiru wa atubu ilayk. The question I asked you, remember? Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim. There's a video I did on it, YouTube. Go on there, inshallah ta'ala. It's the tafsir of Surah Al-Fatiha. I explained it there. Because it's a long answer and it's beneficial. I encourage you. Because the approach I took now is different to the approach I took there. It's on YouTube, you'll benefit from it. Why are many people not guided after reciting Surah Al-Fatiha when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. After He says, اِهْدِنَا صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. This is my slave, and my slave is what he's going to be given what he asks for. Are we all together? And he asked for guidance. So why wasn't he given the guidance that he asked for? صح? There's an answer to that. Go to the YouTube video, inshallah ta'ala, just write Abdurrahman Hassan and then Tafsir Surah Al-Fatiha. It'll come up and watch it from beginning to the end. You'll realize what the answer to that question is. Allah bless you guys, inshallah ta'ala. Bestow His mercy onto you and increase you in beneficial knowledge and righteous action. Barakallahu fi. Jazakumullah khair.
The last point you made about catching the ruku, and is it because there's a weakness in the hadith, or because I remember it's Abu Huraira who was the one who tried to catch the salah, and he was at the end of the masjid and then he made ruku and he crawled. He walked. And the Prophet asked him, did he do that? Is it because there's a weakness in the hadith? So what made you take that position?
And that view that you mentioned of coming to the salah in ruku' is actually Abu Bakr and not Abu Hurairah. But if you look at the same narration, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, man fa'ala hadha, who did this? And he said, me. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, la ta'ud, don't go do that again. The narration says, don't do that again. So I think it works in my advantage.
I remember about this hadith when I was learning usul fiqh. There's four narrations from the hadith about this fi'l that says don't do it again. There's other narrations for that fi'l.
Sahih.
So is that because it's a different narration?
Yeah, the different word is mentioned, different issues, but it's the same event, same particular situation now. Also, the salah hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he said man adraka al-imam raki'a faqad adraka al-raq'a is actually narrated by Abu Hurairah, right? And when he reaches the imam in ruku', he has reached the raq'a, right? And he holds an opinion opposite to what he narrated. This is a mas'ala very important in usul al-fiqh, especially in mustalah al-hadith. Idha khalafa al-rawiyu bima rawa, if al-rawi, a narrator, sahabi, narrates something but holds an opinion opposite to the narration, do we take bima rawa or bima fahim? Do we take what he understood and what he knows and what he's acting upon or what he narrated?
Abdullah ibn Umar said that the Prophet said let the beard grow.
He trimmed it. So that's why some scholars, people argue. Mm-hmm. And plus the hadith where the Prophet said man adraka al-imam raka'a faqad adraka raka'a. Anyone who reaches the imam in ruku' has reached the raka'ah. Does it mean he reached the raka'ah or does it mean he reached the prayer? And can we refer to the salah based on a portion of it? We can. What do we pray that? What do we call the night prayer? What do you call the night prayer? What's the name of the night prayer? Why do you call it qiyam and not ruku' ulayl? Yeah? What do you call it? Is it only standing that we do? Do we not do ruku'? We do sujood, right? You chose a portion of the prayer and named the whole prayer that, right? So here we can say the same. Anyone who reaches the imam in ruku' has caught up with the prayer. In order to reconcile between the what? In order to reconcile between the hadiths. لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب يوم أدرك الإمام راكعا فقد أدرك الركعة. In order to reconcile, لأن we want to be sure that the hadith go together. الجمع واجب متى ما أمكن إلا فللأخير نسخ بينة. In the usul al-fiqh. That to try to reconcile between the evidences takes precedence over strengthening one over the other. So the ones who say, if you reach the ruku' and you reach the ruku', then you've caught the rak'ah, they are dismissing the hadith, la salat al iman lam yaqra' bi fatihat al kitab. You see?
You said just now, do not pray behind an imam who makes severe mistakes in that fatah. Now, if you start praying with him, are you supposed to break away from him, or are you supposed to close it?
You've already come to the prayer.
Yeah, I came and you're mahmoud.
You pray the salah with him, and then you repeat it.
Okay. Finish it and then repeat.
No.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is not a verse of Surah Al-Fatiha.
Ah, Jafir, that's a good question. If we take the basmala out of Surah Al-Fatiha, then if we look at the counting, it's going to be what? 6 and not 7. So what we say is, does anyone know before I answer it? Hey? Ghayr al-Maghdubi is this ayah by itself. Ghayr al-Maghdubi is a what? It's one ayah by itself. So that's how it becomes 7 verses. You say it, but you do not say it loud. You say it, and you can say it, you recite it, but you say it long. You don't say it loud.
What about iftitah?
But if you sometimes say it far high, it's a mas'ala fiqhiyya, aslan, khilaf is very strong. In this country, they recite it loud.
Yeah.
Yes. So if you lead these people to follow that view, it's wise to just do it for them. So it's not an issue. So mas'ala fiqhiyya, you don't want to cause a lot of issue regarding it. No.
So in Malaysia, it's common that before they start prayer, they read Qul A'udhu Rabbi Nas every single time. So what is the?
Yeah, there's no evidence for that. You don't do that. There's no evidence for that.
Sir.
No.
Another question from my sister.
How do you find that?
I heard that if an imam makes a mistake in his recitation, then the other men praying behind him should fix it, and the women praying behind them should clap. If I'm praying with my husband alone and he makes a mistake in the recitation, am I allowed to correct him verbally during the prayer, or is there any other way?
Sorry. Very correct. The sister, she mentioned a good question. She said that if a group of people are praying together, and there's men, and then there's the imam, and there's men behind him, and then the women are right behind there, and the imam does a mistake, and none of the men have the knowledge of the Quran, and they don't know. So what should the women who know do? The narration mentions that they what? They clap to tell the imam that there's a mistake. Okay? If there's in the presence of men, it's not permissible for the woman to recite it. She just shows him that there's a mistake here. Okay? But if it's her and her husband, just the two of them, then inshallah ta'ala, according to some of the views of scholars, ijaiz, it's permissible for her to what? Tell him the verse. Yani, open it for him. Now, can I just say one thing? Benefiting from this opportunity, which is the issue of mothers and investing in them when it comes to the knowledge of the religion. It's very important that we empower our women with Islamic knowledge, and that we give importance to bringing them to the halaqat and the circles of knowledge that we go to. It's very vital. You just don't dismiss them and push them to the side and forget about educating them in the religion. Because the truth is that the mother plays the biggest part of raising the children. And if she learns haqiqatan, if she studies and she, mashallah, learns, the things that she can teach the children are far greater than what the father can. And then I have kids, and when I go home and I sometimes talk to them, they've learned more from their mother than they learned from me. Do you see? So they're always telling me, "Dad, you know you can do this." And I say, "Where do you get this from?" "Mom told us." So it's important that the mother studies and she learns. Al-ummu kal-madrasa. Mother is school, she's a school. She nurtures a whole entire generation. So, a lot of people, they suffer from marital problems. And you know why they do? It's because you went to halaqat every day, you're studying, you're learning, and your wife, you didn't give importance to her growing with you. And so you became high and she is not. And then you guys have different views. And your mindset is so different. But the beginning when you were getting married, you were so similar in things. What solves that problem? Do things together. Study together. Set times in the week where both of you open a video of a sheikh and you take notes together. And you cross the opinions and how you both understood it. Well, did you understand from the statement of the sheikh? Okay, mashallah, I also understood this from it. And you share benefits. The reason why I say you both benefit from someone is sometimes it's hard to teach your wife. Sometimes hard to teach. So maybe use an indirect way of, and saying the truth, the opposite is true. I've seen sisters who are more knowledgeable than their husbands as well. And so it's hard for her to explain to her husband. Like he even if he doesn't know anything and she corrects him, he gets very agitated and angry. So it's hard for her to explain anything to him. So in both parties, I say the same to the sisters and the brothers. And sometimes it's not maybe you that has to teach your partner. Just put the right people in place. Maybe she just bring the right teachers for her and they will teach her. Or both of you become students and just benefit with it. Just don't tell her what you think. So bring a sheikh, put it on, and take notes together. But bring them in with what you're doing. If you're reading something and you come across a benefit, call them if they're not around. Share that benefit with them. Do you know what I just read? SubhanAllah, inna lillah fa'ida azima. Can I share it with you? Fadal, share it with me. Are you with me? Also, sisters, seeking knowledge, sometimes people made it look so structured that you only have to learn it in a structured way. I mean, it is. But it's also important that you can study sometimes in the circumstances that you're put in. For instance, the brother is driving, he's going to work. He's maybe on a route for half an hour, 45 minutes. You can put a lecture on and listen to that lecture. That's Sikh knowledge. It doesn't have to be in a halaqah like that. Are we all together? I know a brother who memorized Riyadhus Salihin. You know how he memorized it? The 15 minutes between the Adhan and the Iqamah and in Salatul Asr. Not 15 minutes, the whole kitab. No, not like that. Over years, for those 15 minutes, he didn't waste it. He just put that Riyadhus Salihin there. Are we all together? I finished Tafsir al-Si'di 14 times in my life, the last 15 minutes before I go to sleep. I don't increase it. It's right next to my pillow. I open it, I read it, a couple of pages of Si'di Tafsir, just before I go to sleep, and I close it. Not too much, right? 15 minutes. So you can do a lot like that. If you just look at those little minutes around you. If the wife is in the kitchen and she's cooking and she's cleaning or she's doing something, then I encourage her to put a lecture on. Get headphones in her ears, put her in her phone, and just focus on listening to that lecture. Are we all together? Like these are moments you can fit in by seeking knowledge. Things like that, for example, when you're working and you're driving, maybe a lesson may not work for you. A lesson may not work for you because you need to take notes. What do? You put muhadarat on, lectures. Iman boosting lectures. And me, what I do sometimes, I travel from one city to another city, I go from one destination to another, I put a lecture, lesson. And then I listen to it. And as I'm listening, if the sheikh says something I did not know of, or a new mas'ala he points out, I pause it. I pull over on the side of the road. I get my pen and paper out. I quickly write the benefit. Put it there. Sometimes one journey, 20, 25 times, I might stop. The goal. So I don't try to waste. Are you with me? Don't waste those opportunities. When I'm traveling to other countries, I designate books for that flight. How many hours that flight? 6 hours. To me, 6 hours, I get one book. I know that I can finish for that journey. And the end of the book, when I finish it, I write on it the date I finished this book and where I finished it. It's encouraging, sir. So it has to, you just have to understand the value of benefiting, squeezing things in different places. Squeezing it. This gadget, wallahi, you can sometimes, you know, you can carry your whole entire library in this and just read it, flick through it, just quickly read it from your mobile phone, quickly to some things. Anyways, the point I wanted to emphasize on is the concept of teaching the sisters and making sure that your wives, your daughters, are learning with you, and that you're not just coming to the halaqat by yourself. I remember one of my cousins, for years I've been telling him one particular thing. It didn't work until he came to a lecture. Sometimes it's not you who can get the message across to them. Came to the lecture, just sat there. It was a concept of being obedient towards your parents. And he got up and he left, crying, went to his mom, became... Are you with me? It was that person who changed his way. Are we all together? So these classes and these benefits, bring your family. Sometimes the message that you've been saying for too long may not be listened to. But if someone else said it, it will be heard. Sorry.
Sheikh, you said the Fatiha is a pillar of the Salah. But if you came to a prayer late and you started reciting the Fatiha and the Imam went to the Rukus, you tried to finish it? Or
no, you follow the Imam. You don't finish like that. You stop, you carry, follow the Imam, and you bring that rak'ah back. If the Imam is, you say, Allahu Akbar, and as soon as you say, Alhamdulillah, Rabbah, Hidah Ruku', you follow the Imam. Ju'ila al-Imam, you follow the Imam, and you bring that rak'ah back. The standing that is, the Imam is in has to give you enough to read Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, Barakallahu feekum, Jazakumullahu khairan, may Allah reward you guys.